Hi, welcome to my review show. Today's guest is the DERYA TM22. Now, for the longest time, we've been depending on China to supply us with cheap guns. But in the last several years, I noticed the prices have been slowly escalating, and sadly, the quality has not kept up. Now, I'm not talking about surplus. I'm talking about newly manufactured semi-auto center fire rifles. They're selling for $1,200. When you consider, you can buy a Canadian-made semi-auto center fire in 5.56 for $1,280, $80 more. Now, how can that be? When you consider the average salary in Toronto is like $5,000 a month, the average salary in Chongqing, that's the manufacturing center, hub of China, is $1,500 Canadian a month. How can, you know, just be an $80 difference? That doesn't make any sense. But about several years ago, I noticed there were some cheap shotguns arriving in Canada. I didn't pay much attention because I didn't know much about the country of Turkey. Till 2.5 years ago, I bought this. Yes, it's a Stoger Cougar. I paid $350. And when I received it, I was shocked at the quality. It was very good. If it wasn't for the finishing, I would swear it was made in Italy. But no, it was made in Turkey. Now, last year, Big Box Store had a sale on Charles Daly 101 410 shotgun for $125. I bought one, and the quality wasn't too bad. And I was thinking, for $125, that's like 4 hours of average wages. Nobody can make a shotgun for 4 hours in 4 hours, you know, even out of plumbing pipe. So yeah, I think the country of Turkey is probably our next source of cheap guns. So that's why I bought this. But let me go back a little bit about the history about this particular TM-22. It first arrived in Canada about 2 years ago via the USA by a company called Rock Island Armory. They, I guess, contracted DERYA to make the TM-22 for them, but it was like a M4 copy, right? It looked like an M4, and it was made out of plastic. And I was not interested on a M4 lookalike, especially in plastic, since I have a Chinese-made M4. In 5.56. Unfortunately, I can't fire this anymore. But, and that one, the RIA in the US, the M4 lookalike, it's called Feather, by the way. It came in a 20-inch barrel and an 18-inch barrel. And Canadians could import them in for, I think they were retailing for between just close to just above $200 US. Okay, I think by the time they arrived here, probably $100 more, so maybe about $330 Canadian, even after the conversion and the transport and all that stuff, taxes, and that's probably where it was. But like I said, the Feather was made out of plastic, so I was not interested at all. And then later on, we had something similar to this, except it has I think it came with a fixed stock, an L-shaped stock, and it had 3/4 handguard, the aluminum handguard. But this model came all aluminum, of course, except for the grip and the stock. And that's when I started to take notice. And when it came in with the full aluminum handguard, I was more interested in it. And this one I paid $570 Canadian. For what I got for $570 Canadian, I got an Allen wrench, I got a castle nut wrench, I had a manual, and of course, that's nothing. And I also got two 10-round magazine, and these magazines are made out of aluminum, okay, alloy. Now this magazine, those hold 10 rounds each. This one, I paid a ridiculous amount of $32 for them, Canadian, and it holds 15, but it's made out of plastic. Now, I know they overcharged me for that because you can buy a GSG 16 that holds 22 rounds, okay, and it's made in Germany for the same price. So obviously, this is made in Turkey and charging me the same price of a magazine that's made in Germany. That's a little steep, if you ask me. That's my opinion. In any case, let me cover the stats first and then I'll go into the review. Okay, the weight is 6.28 pounds. And that is what I noticed right away when I picked this gun up. It felt like a gun, okay? Not like the GSG 16. When I first picked that up, it felt like a toy. And that's why a couple of years later, the manufacturing GSG put in a block of cylinder steel in the grip. And foolishly, some of the owners of the GSG 16 were removing them. No, don't remove them. That's the whole point, is to make you add that weight. It also balance the gun better when it's in the grip. Okay. Now, the trigger weight is a sweet averaging 1 pound, 10 ounces. LLP, minimum LLP is 12 and a half, max is 15 and three quarters. Overall length is 33 and a quarter, min and max is 36 and a half. Now you're probably wondering, why is the barrel 18 and a half inch long? Probably for regulations in Turkey. Certainly is not in the U.S. U.S. The 16, it could be 16 without any problem. Of course, in Canada, when I measure from here to here, 26 inches will bring it up to here. So it's about 7 inch too long. So if it's over here 26 inch, it could even go as low as 10 and a half inch barrel or 11 inch barrel. So could we see that down the road? Yeah, I guess we could. We could see a 16 inch barrel. And there's a company in Vancouver that's already supplying a shorter barrel. I think they're 11 inches that you could install yourself. Okay. So hang around, I'll be back, and I'll begin with the review. I am back. Now, I read the manual, and there's nothing special in there. So I'll just put that aside. Let me start from the back and work my way to the front. Okay. As you all know, this is an M4 stock, and it's really well made. And it has a riser, okay, and how you operate is unscrew that, and it can move up about an inch and a quarter. Let me move that, and you can just pull that up, and you can gain a height of an inch and a quarter, and you can push it down after you unloosen that, okay. The butt pad is rubberized, okay. Unfortunately, there's not a whole lot of places for a sling. One over here, and there's just basically a hole, and that's too bad. They could have used that hole as a QD for the sling, and it's not. Okay, it's just a hole, and that's unfortunate. They could have taken that opportunity and made that into a QD, but otherwise, I do like the design, and this is the lock. It operates really well, and it has five different positions, okay, and it gains, let's see, it gains about 3.5 inches, so that's really good. This tube is a commercial tube, and I haven't had a chance to take it apart to see what's inside, but I did manage to slide this Magpole buttstock in there. I even got this cheapy from AliExpress, and that fit right in there. It's a commercial. Now, this is also, I guess, taking after the AR, and you see it has the finger groove, one of them, and it's nice texture. Okay, it has a nice grip on it. It's rubberized. There is a bottom cap underneath this thing, and you have to use a Phillips, I guess it's one of the smallest Phillips, to unscrew that screw, and then you have to basically use a thin knife and pull up this cap. Okay, it doesn't fall out easily, so you have to sort of dig that out, and there will be some space you can put down some battery, and you can also put this wrench in there. You'll need this wrench to do your field stripping. Okay, then you come up to the trigger, and this trigger is a little different. It's kind of straight, you see that? I'm not kind of used to it, but I'll get used to it. And like I said, the trigger pull weight is a sweet 1 pound 10 ounces. Okay, now this magazine is alloy, the one that comes with the rifle. You get two of them, two 10 rounds. And I presume that the reason why they're 10 is probably because in Turkey they probably have that regulation or something. Certainly not in the States and not here. And you just put that in. Okay, it looks kind of weird, you know, looking like this. I don't particularly like the shape of the magazine. You see these two bumps? I guess there's some sort of a screws that goes all the way through, and I don't know why they couldn't have just went straight across, you know, and eliminate that bump and made it bigger or wider. You know what I'm saying? On the second half. I don't know why they didn't do that. I would prefer it if they did that. Okay. The thing that I found negative, aside from the magazine, is also the magazine catch. It's this. It looks like a pistol catch, mag catch. You see how small that is? That's quite tiny. Okay. Let me press it. Luckily, the magazine does fall out. I don't know if it does with the plastic one. Probably not. No, it does. It does. That follow too. Okay. Now it does have a BHO feature, but it's not the regular BHO you're thinking of. That's in the GSG 16. Okay. It's not a separate bolt hole feature. Okay. What it is, it's almost like the Yugo that uses the follower. In the Yugo, the bolt get caught in the back of this follower in the magazine. Right, so that when you run out of ammo, this follower comes up, and then when the bolt tries to move forward, it gets caught in the back of this follower. I don't particularly like that in the long term, because repeated hitting the back of this follower will obviously damage it. And not only that, is that when you want to replace, okay, this tells you you're empty, right? And now you want to change the magazine to put a loaded one, but every time you press this and pull the magazine down, the bolt goes forward. See? That's the downside of using the follower as a BHO. So I don't particularly like that, and I don't see why they can't have develop a real BHO. When you pull down the magazine, it still stays open. On the other side, I know there was some issues when they first came out, this model, I'm not sure about if the Feather model had that same issue, but the selector was reverse. In other words, okay, this one has been fixed. This one has a white button at the bottom, okay, to fire. You pull this down, and now you're ready to fire. In the other previous model, it was the reverse, okay? So to fire, you have to use that thumb to push it up, and to put a safe, you push it down. Okay, so people did not like that, but in this case, they had that fixed, okay? One thing about this selector I don't like is that when you're ready to fire, you show inside here, there's a small hole. That's a place for your dirt to go in and cause some trouble. I don't like that, okay? All right. Another thing that was a big issue with the previous model, or actually even with this model, is when there's a, in front of this buffer tube, there's a white plastic, okay? It's sort of a buffer, the bolt from going back. Unfortunately, that tends to wear out, okay? The buffer gets tend to wear out, and what happens is that this cocking handle ends up hitting here and breaking off, okay? So that is a problem. Obviously, this cocking handle is way too small if it breaks off like this, right? It's a very small cocking handle. Obviously, nobody would like that small of a cocking handle. And that's also another reason why it broke off. When your buffer plastic, I guess, when it broke, it meant your bolt was going back further, and then this cocking handle end up hitting the back, this opening, and that's why it broke off. And that's what they should do, is fix that by making this a little bit wider, making it a little longer, by an eighth. So even if the back of your bolt hits the buffer tube, it wouldn't break that off. Okay, that's what they should do. Okay, I kind of noticed that this area is rather beefy, pretty thick, and I guess it's sort of a doubles as a barrel block, and this is where your barrel is. And this is unlike the real M4 or the AR, where you have a top receiver and the lower, this one is one whole piece. And so the way to remove the bolt is to remove the receiver cover. This is a receiver cover that doubles as a rail, okay? So you have to remove these hex screws, okay? And that's the reason why they provided you an Allen wrench. And then you can remove this aluminum handguard. And, remove the handguard, and then this comes off, and then you have access to the bolt. And let's move forward. Now this handguard weighs 300 grams. Not too bad. Has a lot of M-locks at 9, 6, 3, and 9. And it feels great in the hand. The barrel muzzle has a muzzle protector. It protects half by 28, which is the AR muzzle threading. And here I have a A2 bird cage, and let me check. It does fit, so that's what is it for. Not that you really need one for a 22, but it sure looks pretty cool, doesn't it? Yes, it does. Okay, now, as far as the design goes, I still have a little bit of reservation. I still haven't taken it down, so I can't really say, because I see there's a couple of these roll pins here, there's a C-clip here. So I'm not sure how is that worked. I might have to disassemble it before I can actually give you an opinion. But let me briefly take this apart, and you have to remove the cocking handle, okay? It's just basically a hex screw, okay? And this is your tiny little caulking hand. And then to remove the aluminum handguard, you got to loosen this screw. Okay. Now, if you think there's too many screws to unloosen just to do field stripping, I would say that's not too bad, because G16 is the same thing. You have to use screwdrivers and Allen wrench to remove the bolt. So this one goes straight forward after you do that, and this just slides out. Okay, that's about it. And this is what the barrel looks like. It's a pretty thick barrel, which is good, you know. And I believe you can remove this barrel by yourself. I haven't done it yet. Now, to get at the bolt, you have to remove these two hex screw on top, up top of the Picatinny rail. Now, before you pull up on the receiver cover, I would ask you to be a little cautious, okay, because the recoil spring might jump out. So put your hand in the back here, okay, and slowly lift the receiver cover. Once this cover comes off, then you lift the spring up like this, and because you already removed the caulking handle, you can actually remove the whole bolt up like this. And this is what it looks inside. Okay, I haven't actually know how to remove the BCG yet, so I don't know. But this is as far as you go as field stripping. Now, this bolt has a recoil spring, a rod, and the rod goes inside this brass cylinder. Okay, and this is your firing pin, and it's made out of alloy, and I like the fact that it has two extractors. Okay. And that hole is where the firing pin comes out. And here I want to show you what the design flaw is. Okay, to put it together, you slide this straight rod in like this. Okay. And then it goes into the receiver. It just drops in like that. Okay. Now, in the front, there's a half circular cut in the front, and there's also a half round circular cut in the back. And the reason for that is this is where your recoil guide rod goes in like this, and I think this is a poor design. This design flaw I'm talking about, I saw this in the GSG-16. GSG-16 has a dual recoil spring. Okay, originally they did not have, they just basically had a spring on the rod, and what happens is that eventually the spring got, the ends got mangled up, because and this is the same thing I see right here. Okay, here I'm gonna give you an example. You see that, because this spring here, it sits like this. Okay, it sits like this, and you see it's up against, I would say, like maybe 60% of it is against the back of the receiver, while 40% is not touching anything, the spring, right? So if you somehow maybe didn't tighten up this top receiver cover, or maybe the screw got loose, then this will rise. When it rise, this can rise. And you see what happens? If this start to rise, now less part of the spring is touching the back of the receiver, and eventually it'll be damaged, as you can see, right? And that is of concern, is that if this start to loosen, that screw start to loosen, and this start to separate from the top of the receiver, and this, what could happen to the spring. So what I'm suggesting is that this rod shouldn't just be a straight rod. It should be, it should have a piece going across like that. Okay. See these lines? This is a spring. And they should have a, like a plate at the end. And the spring should be resting on the plate and not resting on the back of the receiver. So that is the one thing I wish they would correct that. And it wouldn't be very expensive to put a, I guess, a disc plate in the back here, a washer plate, you know. So it would be up against the plate and not up against the receiver. That's where it could be damaged. That's my recommendation, because I find that this was the same problem we saw on GSG. And subsequent models did have two washer added. Okay, so this goes back like this. Okay, and then it, you got to pull the spring back and then push the rod into that space. That's a flaw, a minor flaw anyway. And one more thing I want to point out while I'm here is that this is the white buffer that do get damaged, right? And then it gets pushed in. And when that get this white get pushed in, it means the bolt is going all the way to the back. Okay. Now there is a solution to fixing this this problem. I don't know if this has been fixed, but when I take it apart, I'll get to look at it. So basically that's it. I still think this the quality is good. I do like the quality. It's made out of metal. Everything except for the these two accessories that is quite common with the AR and M4s. I recommend it for what I see right now, but I haven't investigated what this is all about. So I'll have to look into that, and I'll get back to you. So in the meantime, I like it, and I recommend it. So thank you for being with me. Please hit the like and subscribe button.